Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Pavilion of the Sustainable Agriculture of the Americas. We're so glad you're here. As you can tell, we have lots of exciting things going on near us. We have former Vice President Al Gore right next door. And so we're happy that he's sharing a little bit about what he's doing. And we may hear some of that during this session. He's been an important leader in the fight against climate change. So that's really great. We are here today to welcome all of you. We have a wonderful partner. EECA is very happy to partner with Crop Life International, Crop Life Latin America, and all the Crop Lives. And we have a wonderful panel, and it's so amazing. We have all the ladies, all the women in the room. Woo! It's a wonderful panel. And so we just want to say thank you again to Crop Life and to our partners who have helped partner with us for many years in sustainable agriculture in the Americas and around the world too. So I'm going to turn it over now to Jamie Adams from USDA, who's going to be the moderator for the panel. Thank you, Jamie.
Thank you so much, Margaret. It's so exciting to be here with you all today. Again, my name is Jamie Adams. I'm with the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And I am also, maybe just give another shout out here to having an all-female panel on the stage. That's so exciting. And women are really leading at the forefront of the climate crisis and making those challenges become a reality. So I'm excited to join you today as the moderator, delivering promise for the future, the next generation of plant science innovations. I also have the pleasure of leading the Agriculture Innovation Mission for Climate, or AIM for Climate, for the United States government with colleagues from across the U.S. government. And we're excited to be here today shortly, and about 24 hours joined by Secretary Vilsack, and having many events in the next couple of days to feature new announcements in the road ahead to COP28 for AIM for Climate. And that is a topic that I think you'll hear a lot about from our speakers today, many of which are here representing AIM for Climate Innovation Sprints. And it's a novel concept where we are using innovation sprints to amplify the voices of our partners. A lot of them are public-private partnerships to really drive change, rapid transformation in food and food systems and agriculture. And so we're really excited to have this wonderful panel of speakers here today. So the way we're going to do this, I'm going to go through, each have some remarks. We have another presenter that'll join via video. And so we'll do an introduction and then they'll present. We'll go through the presentations and then we'll circle back at the end for questions from the audience. So I'd encourage you to think as you're hearing the speakers of questions. We really want to hear from the audience and address those questions that come to mind from the presentation. So we'll make sure to leave time for that in the end. So with that, I'm excited to get started here. And first, we have Natasha Santos, who is the head of Global Stakeholder Affairs and Strategic Partnerships for Bayer Crop Science. So if I could turn the floor to Natasha.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. I thought we were going to have an empty panel, but friends here and maybe not friends as well, we welcome. So I'm not going to do a presentation. We're going to have very amazing and very detailed presentations following from the amazing panelists here. I decided to talk about how I'm feeling. After 4 days here at COP in Egypt, talking to a lot of people, listening our people, listening. I was in a panel yesterday with some bankers, which was the finance day. And the bankers were talking mainly about agriculture on that panel, which made me very happy. And then I think that's the feeling that I'm having after 4 days. I don't know about you guys, and I want to save time for Q&A, but the feeling that I have is that finally, we've made agriculture part of one of the priority topics at COP, right? And thank you, EECA, for being one of those partners that is raising the voice here. And then I think that's great. We are on stage because of many challenges that agriculture have. And I'll use one example of investment and solutions that we are thinking. The title of my presentation is Sustainable Rice. And I'll talk about that in a second, but I think we've made it. We're finally on stage and I see a lot of friendly faces and farmers here. But we need to help to move the narrative, as we hear a lot, move the narrative from agriculture from the challenge and the problems and, you know, the pain points to the solutions, and trying to bring as many examples, as many concrete ways to move forward and to have agriculture, as we discussed it a lot and was a publication recently, as part of, is the only sector, and I guess one of the few sectors that is really can be part of the adaptation and mitigation. So we need to talk about more about the concrete examples and the solutions that are already happening. I know we have a North Star and we need to keep pushing forward, but there's so many things already happening on the ground where we are learning. We are learning things that don't work, but we are learning things that work, and how we can scale that and how we can foster more public-private partnerships, but as well partnerships across the value chain where everybody takes their responsibility as well to move forward. So how we can take more partnership in the value chain to really accelerate what we want for agriculture in a way that is inclusive for farmers, in a way that address their pain points, but really put agriculture as part of the national agendas and part of the solution in climate and adaptation and mitigation. So today I brought one example on rice, and I think some of you are familiar with rice. And I want to share a bit about the Sustainable Rice Initiative and what we have learned so far, not only us as an organization, but with the partners that join us and with the farmers that are part of some of our pilots and some of the investments that we have, particularly in India, but this can be translatable to other rice investments that we have, particularly in Asia. So I organized my presentation today in five areas. First of all, about the issues, who is not as familiar with agriculture, I think we are aware that rice is one of the number one methane emission. If it's the number one cropping system that is a highly methane emitter. Another challenge with rice is the labor intensive. So how we do a transition in a way that we address the labor intensive, and how we think about how we move on upskilling and how we move the next steps with the labor that is part of that cropping system. So issues, few issues. Second, what are the challenges that the farmers have? Some of the challenges are, we know that in rice, particularly in India, there is a low level of technology. So going back to the topic of today, technology. So low level of technology, low level of machinery. And I'm going to talk about the new system that we have been investing. We have lack of market awareness. We have lack of farm management tools. Those are smallholder farmers, right? We have some challenges in terms of how we make implementable the value mechanisms that we are putting forward. Then the third piece, look at opportunities. So we are here talking about the system transformation. And then here I'm talking about transforming the system to direct seeded rice, from transplanting to direct seeded rice. And then the opportunities are this system transformation can really contribute directly from an economic and from an environmental benefits. And I've been talking about this since Monday when we announced it with a few value chain players, an action plan on what is being called regenerative agriculture. And from an environmental benefits, this sustainable rice investment is so transformational because it directly, from the pilots that we have, it directly contributes to water usage up to 40%, directly contributes to reduce methane emission up to 25% from some of the pilots. It already addressed the labor intensity and quality in terms of labor in that system. So it's really a transformational piece, particularly because it talks about smallholders. Then the fourth piece, to really enable that system, and maybe when we are not with the agricultural colleagues or the agricultural organizations, we lack talking about that, is really how can we address the farmers' pain points? And then technology comes here. Again, so what are the main farmers' pain points in that new system? Is the seed selection, right? Thinking about the best variety. So we need to have a breeding system. We need to think about the best varieties and that access to the farmers. Second, today, the farmers already have labor shortage. When we're thinking about the transplanting system, they need labor for transplanting. They need labor for irrigation management. Then when we think about changing a system or changing practices, we need to think about capacity building, how you upskill. So it's really an ecosystem challenge that we have. And maybe the third piece, which that's the reason why we need more private-private partnerships as well in the value chain, is thinking about market access. So how we can improve price negotiation skills and knowledge, how we can make sure that we address the grain quality, right? How we can make sure that we address storage when we think about the traders. So moving from the transplanting rice to something like direct seeded rice, which can directly contribute to the environmental outcomes that we talk about in regenerative agriculture and climate smart agriculture, we need to address those farmer pain points, and we cannot take that for granted. Reason why we need partnerships, as I mentioned. So what do we need to do? I think two areas, and I'll close my opening remarks. I think, first of all, we talk about farmer-centric. I think we need to be farmer-centric, otherwise we're not going to address those pain points and those challenges. So I think the next steps for me, I divide it in two main areas. One, thinking about the farmers, we need to create solutions that are simple for the farmers, right? Early plant establishment, how we address weed management on this new weed management system on this new system. We need to ensure yields. We talk about a lot of dropping yields, but we need to ensure yields in this transition and make sure we have the economic value and the risk sharing when that change happens. And then we need to foster demand. So is the value chain involved? What is the value that the downstream will bring on this new system? We need to think about policy environments, particularly in India. And I think in these discussions that we're having on the sides here with the parties, how we address the tension, not attention, but how we make sure that we enable voluntary markets so we can think about offsets, but we make sure that those transformation and those environmental friendly solutions like directed seeded rice are supported by policy, and they are addressed on countries and NDCs. And we avoid things like double counting, of course, but the pathway on the NDCs for that country is included of solutions like, in a way, ecosystem solutions like directed seed rice. So that's what I wanted to share with you today on my opening remarks, and then looking forward engaging on a Q&A and then going into more details of this example or any other example that we'll discuss today. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Natasha. Yes, please. And I really appreciated your farmer-centric examples, and thank you so much for sharing those details. And next we have Anjali Marok, the head of global responsibility for Corteva Agriscience. Thank you for joining us today. The floor is yours.
Great. Thank you, Jamie. First question is, can everybody hear me? Sounds like it got a bit quieter over there. And the second question I have for you is, how many of you have been visiting pavilions beyond the very exciting 4 to 5 food and ag pavilions that we finally have here at COP? Any hands up for going beyond the bubble? Okay, phenomenal. So the reason I ask this is because I suspect that here today we are largely speaking to the bubble. So my next question is, how many of you are our most important stakeholders, farmers or related to farmers? Phenomenal. And how many of the rest of you are working in ag today? And how many of you really understand and believe yourselves that agriculture is a solution and innovation plays a role in that? All right, we are talking to ourselves. That's phenomenal. So the reason I ask that is a fewfold. One is it's coming up on tea time, and I'm sure that you are looking for that long coffee line just like I am. But also because when we talk about Aim for Climate, and Jamie, some of what you had shared before, you know, when you think about what sprint looks like, multi-stakeholder looks like, collaboration looks like, part of that is us all, to your point, working together, public-private partnerships, private-private partnerships. Absolutely. But if you've been beyond the bubble here at COP, you've probably heard ag referred to as a potential solution to other pavilions' challenges, and potentially still being discussed as a potential contributor and challenge as well. So my challenge to you, and I will say things about Corteva too, because that's what I was asked to do, but challenge to you is, that as you listen to some of these examples here today, and as you continue to go around your day today over the course of the week, we finally have an Ag Day. So as you celebrate that on Saturday, what examples, what specific things can you take beyond our bubble to help share the potential of these solutions to those who are asking for them beyond our own pavilions? Because I think in the spirit of the Aim for Climate efforts, SPRINT really means bringing everyone together with the best solutions that may already exist today. And I think sometimes that means looking to core competencies that exist and have existed for years within our own industry and continue to evolve, but maybe that also means bringing others in as well. So, small soapbox, thanks for tolerating that. But just a little bit of something to get your juices going here today. So I say that all because you all know, as Ag family, that our industry has a long history of stewardship. There is no choice. In agriculture, it is a requirement. And you also know that there is a dependency in our industry on that very same stewardship. We could not continue to what we do today, contribute to production of food, fuel, or fiber without that stewardship. And that makes this a particularly exciting COP and a particularly exciting time for ag, because we finally have a day on Saturday, a soil health day tomorrow, discussion around youth and innovation today, and finance, which we know is a huge challenge in agriculture, yesterday. And the list goes on. Biodiversity, water next week. This is our space. And it's wonderful that we are taking this space. But I don't know if you know, but Jamie, you shared this with me earlier. I hope it's okay that I share that ag was almost not a day here at COP27. Would you believe that? And it's thanks to voices like the USDA that we actually have the ability to showcase these potential solutions on a dedicated day. Critical. You know, what we know is that keeping up with the pace of unpredictability and change is a challenge. And at the center of that, innovation and technology is a fundamental tool to keeping up, potentially even getting ahead of the curve when it comes to that unpredictability and change. And given that dependency that we have on agricultural production for food and food security and so much more beyond that, and even more to come, that innovation is absolutely critical, which means that acceleration, which means that collaboration. So I offer for you 4 A's that are needed to help support innovation and advancement in considering how these sprints play a role. And the first is access. Access goes back to innovation and technology. Without the tools that can help to withstand climate shocks, tools that are able to be resilient to not only the climate change impacts that affect agriculture, but also the increasing disease pressures, the increasingly unpredictable disease pressures, and other pest pressures that will continue to migrate and evolve because of climate change, that access is critical. Acceptance, so acceptance of that technology, the ability to bring it into the hands of farmers so that they can choose what is right for their acres, for their fields. And advancement, we are where we are today, but we know that there is so much more coming to us, coming toward us, and so much more that we can do to contribute. And so continuing that advancement through continuous improvement is absolutely critical. And then finally, acknowledgement, and this is where all of you play a role, acknowledgement here at every pavilion across however many buildings here, that ag is presenting solutions and opportunities for climate mitigation and climate adaptation. So that probably sounds like a lot of pontificating, and I'm sure it is. But here's a little bit about Corteva. So at Corteva, we look at agricultural tools as part of a holistic solution. So when we produce seeds, crop protection, and bring digital innovation to bear to support not only the innovation, but how that's brought to farmers, we're looking for opportunities for holistic solutions that enable ecosystem of the farm to be advanced, to be benefited, not just for one season, but for many seasons to come. And I think that's a lot of what all of us are here working on. At Corteva, we have a commitment to sustainable innovation that's comprised of 12 sustainable innovation criteria. Each of those is tied to a sustainable development goal. And so when we talk about translating what we do here in agriculture to the common language here at a UN-based event, that common language allows us to share the great work of farmers and what these tools can contribute to any number of people well beyond our bubble. And so that acknowledgement is key. But here we are today talking about innovation. So, you know, when we think about crop protection, today 90% of our crop protection innovations meet the sustainable innovation criteria that we have laid out, which means that there's room to do more, room to do better, and then room to raise the bar. From a seed technology standpoint, think about the excess of rain that some corners of the world have experienced this year, the lack of rain that many areas of the world have experienced this year, any number of other challenges. And if there's two more months, let's hope it's it's a smooth 2 months, but you know, there's so much more yet to come. All of these technologies come to bear to do their best to help protect risk for farmers and continuously advance to do more. So with that, I want to share one example with you for our collaboration with AIM for Climate, a sprint partnership that we have. But before I do that, how many of you know about what kind of benefits innovation can have from an economic standpoint on the farm? Are they economically viable? See, all the farmers put their hands up because they know that that's how it works. It's about livelihoods as much as it is about economic advancement and social advancement. So the example that I want to share with you is a collaboration that came together back in 2020 between Corteva and Land O'Lakes in a partnership that was formed called the Nourishing Prosperity Alliance. And this partnership was designed to empower women smallholder farmers in Kenya in order to improve their dairy production and in turn increase their income while reducing methane emission from cows. And so I'm going to turn my page because this is a very exciting partnership, but the detail really matters here. So like I said, ultimately this is about life, livelihoods, and through this partnership, empowering 5,000 smallholder women dairy farmers in Kiambu and Meru in Kenya. This was a jointly developed partnership that brings along a pilot program that includes collaboration with international and local partners like Forage Genetics International, like the International Livestock Research Institute, in a way that creates an alliance model for other local and international organizations to also come on board in order to help provide community access to nutritional, animal-sourced foods. So all of that is done. You think, why? Where does innovation play into that? Because that's an impact story. That's a livelihood story. All of this is built off of providing climate-optimized corn silage seed to these farmers and pairing that with sharing access to advanced forage testing, developing market linkages for whatever gets produced, right? The milk that gets produced from these dairy farmers, and then training on best practices for dairy management for these women. And through all of this, we've been named an AIM for Climate Innovation Sprint finalist, which will be announced here at COP27 at some point. Because I think of these linkages, not just across the partnerships themselves, but fundamentally the sharing access to the knowledge that allows this to be replicated, potentially scaled in a number of different ways, in a number of different geographies, in a number of different crop and production systems. But with this one project alone, with this one pilot effort, as it grows alone, this project is targeting the following things by 2025, which, if you can believe it, is not too much more than 2 years away. They're working towards improved dairy productivity in over 700,000 cows, improved productivity by 25%, which is significant, increased soil quality and retention in over 250,000 hectares of farmland, and reduced farm methane emissions intensity by 15% across 120,000 farms. So from 500 women smallholders empowered to something that can truly scale. So just some food for thought, that as Corteva, we're looking at holistic solutions, but together we are looking at a system. And when we can pull together alliances and partnerships for system, we can really work towards achieving sustainable transformation, which is what the world is calling on agriculture to deliver.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And I love the example and the detail that you provided on the innovation sprint. So really much, it's getting loud. So I'm going to try to speak up here a little bit more. So next we have Dan Voitis, who's going to join us by video, I believe. He is the professor of genetics, the University of Minnesota, speaking on the potential impacts of genome editing on climate adaptation and mitigation. Over to Dan.
My name is Dan Voitis. I'm a professor at the University of Minnesota. And for the past 20 years or so, my lab has been working on developing ways in which we can make specific changes to the plant genetic coding. We refer to this as plant gene editing. Many of you have probably heard of CRISPR, and indeed, the CRISPR technology was the recipient, or the advent of CRISPR technology, and resulted in the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2020. And clearly, CRISPR and other gene editing platforms have been spending better synthesis. Gene editing allows precise alterations to plant genomes, and it enables us to understand how plant genes work and function, and then to harness this information so that we can develop new crop varieties. So when we think about climate change, clearly it's going to have an enormous impact on plant agriculture. We're going to have to develop plant varieties that can withstand extremes of weather, heat, drought, flooding. And further, as climate change comes to the fore, ecosystems are going to adapt, and the geographic range of them, insect, fungal, bacterial pathogens are also going to be changed. So, platforms will be increasingly exposed to new disease potential. Further, we're going to want and need to be able to grow plants with less inputs, such as fertilizers will be increasing the cost of the agriculture economy. And in some cases, they also break their action, also control its climate change. So, gene editing, how can gene editing help develop plants that are able to withstand a change in climate? Well, gene editing really allows us to create very precise genetic variation. And so if you think about it, for thousands of years, farmers have been taking advantage of genetic variation that occurs spontaneously. So the earliest farmers would grow their crops and save the seed from the plants that were the most productive and planted them year after year. And slowly, species were transformed. So, for example, modern maize, to compare modern maize to its wild relative, Teosinte, they hardly resemble each other. And this transformation from Teosinte to maize really occurred because of genetic variation that arose spontaneously over time. And the beauty of gene editing is we can create this genetic variation in plants within the time is a few months or a year. As we increasingly understand how plant genes and genes function, we can make targeted modifications to the plant genetic material to produce plants that can better withstand the stresses of the changing climate. Now, it's been a decade or so since the CRISPR technology and certain gene editing platform was first described. And although 10 years might seem like a long period of time, we're still actually in the early stages of deploying this technology for crop improvement. But already, there's been many improvements in many plant species. And we can see that in the not too distant future, how this technology can really help produce crop varieties that meet the same, better the same climate change. So let me give you a few examples. And the plants of the future are going to need to withstand increasing amounts of abiotic stress. Again, abiotic stress includes extremes of heat, drought, or weather. Already we know, for example, the rice of some genes that confer flood intolerance. And because we understand the genetic basis of this trait, it can now go into other rice varieties, and we have varieties of other species in perhaps even gene editing to distribute this trait on the other end. Many traits of drought tolerance or heat tolerance require the action of many genes. And in some instances, we're still only understanding the genetic basis of the pathways. But gene editing can really help in this. So for example, I'm part of a consortium with something that's trying to understand drought tolerance in species such as sorghum and millet and maize. When we use gene editing to, again, explore the genetic basis of drought tolerance, and then hopefully with gene editing, we can implement these traits so that they can be greatly. As I mentioned, plants, I think in the coming years, are going to have to be more resistant to pests and pathogens. And climate change is going to alter the geographic distribution of those pests. But already gene editing has been used to create varieties that are resistant to fungal or bacterial pathogens. For example, a gene edited wheat has been part of resistance to powdery mildew. Or gene edits in species in such as rice have confirmed resistance and tolerance to various bacterial pathogens. Normally, traditionally, as the disease breaks out in the field, breeders come to the rescue by identifying disease resistant varieties in that particular crop and then crossing those varieties to remove the disease resistance onto the cultivated. But gene, this is, not in case upwards of a decade, but in little as a year, gene editing has been shown to be able to contribute to traits, such as the bacteria and fungal patterns that I just mentioned. One application of gene editing that I think might be valuable in climate change, I refer to as de novo domestication. I described our chiasente, the years of selection by farmers was ultimately transformed into maize. It's likely that we're going to need additional plant species that can grow on marginal land. One of my graduate students is interested in applying gene editing to a grain staple of East Africa. This is called teff. And teff is really, in any respects, a wild species. The stems are very stiff, and so wind and rain can cause lodging and loss of seed, the seeds shatter, and I can hard to harvest. But gene editing is already been used in tech to create so many dwarf varieties that are more sturdy in stature and promise to have more steel. So there are many applications of gene editing that can be used to improve crops, for example, Another application that I find interesting is to edit cultivated varieties so that they produce more of the products we're interested in. Here's an example. Soybean is grown in the US and it's an important source of protein for humans and animals. And but when the seed is crushed, it also gives rise to oil, and that is very valuable for cooking. And we use different types of oils from different plants for different purposes. So palm oil from Malaysia and Indonesia is valuable for products. That's need this oil for certain food applications. So it's like a margarine substitute. But you know, we've altered the soybean genome so that it now can make different types of oil. And one variety we created, and it produces oil much more akin to the sunflower oil, which is useful for frying. And so I can imagine that the dead soybean genome also kind of problem for now. Then there'd be a domestic source of this oil. We didn't have to grow it in the most Malaysia and Indonesia, which is the deep oil station. And we wouldn't have to transport that oil around the world. We could simply grow these gene edited soybean varieties to create the corn oil, a sustainable source to become the protein. I also think plants and application of gene editing plants can help mitigate some of the excess carbon that's in the atmosphere. So there are ongoing efforts to engineer plants so that they're more photosynthetically efficient. For example, maize and sorghum carry out a process called C4 photosynthesis that is highly efficient. If we could engineer other crops like rice, which use a different photosynthetic mechanism, we can make that capture carbon more efficiently from the atmosphere and likely significantly increase the yields from these engineered rice. And finally, an idea that's captured the imagination of many people is using plants to capture atmospheric carbon and sequester underground in the soil, where it's very slow to be re-released back in the atmosphere. There's an interest in engineering roots so that they're larger, and so that they also produce carbon rich compounds such as sebum that are resistant to break and so you capture carbon from the atmosphere and put it in the environment. And my efforts are ongoing to use various approaches, including genetics, to achieve these outcomes. So as I mentioned, gene editing is still in its infancy in many respects. And so I think of recommendations going forward. I think one would be to invest in additional research so that we can accelerate and scale the production of gene editing. Right now, I mentioned it's fast compared to some other methods of creating genetic variation, but we still have to do it in the laboratory, growing cells sterile in culture. It's not going to take several months to do it. We can create people come up with new ways to edit gene plants. It didn't require the use of the petri dish in the laboratory and such. And I think very quickly accelerate production of gene plants. Another area I think that gene editing can be applied to is like kind of trait discovery. As I mentioned, a consortium with scientists are trying to understand drug products of implants. And these are complex traits. And I think additional uses of gene editing and understand the genes underlying these traits could be a value so that we could then harness that information to create more climate resilient crops. And of course, another important issue, less related to the science, concerns regulatory policy. So the changes to plant genomes that I described are really no different than that genetic variation that arises in human cells. So, you know, the end product applications, many applications of gene editing is not the genome, a GMO free in the plant has foreign DNA in certain genes. So I think the acceleration of the use of the technology will benefit from having a regulatory policy, global regulatory policy that is harmonized on that name, so that multiple different developments in unity that certain applications of GMO editing should not be regulated, and therefore products of gene editing would be grown and could be distributed throughout the year without running into regular environments that would limit distribution of gene editing products on a global scale. So I'm very excited about the opportunities for gene editing and for its plant agriculture and the challenges that plant agriculture may face in the coming years. So I very much hope that we continue to invest in this technology in recognition of the power of the technology for solving some of these pressing issues related to plant agriculture and change on it.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dan. And it's always good to have the science perspective. Such great detail and explanation for those of us who may not have as much background and understanding what we really see is on the cutting edge and the forefront in gene editing. And so next up, we have Inji Zaki, who is the Regional Sustainability and Digitalization Manager, Agricultural Solutions, the Nile and Middle East for BASF. And I believe she has some slides. They're up. Wonderful. On happy. Am I pronouncing that right?
Correct.
Okay. Wonderful. Happy. We are all very happy to be here and soon to have Ag Day, as said earlier, on early disease warning systems. So please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Jamie. First of all, I'm very happy to take part of this very interesting panel. I have a very concrete example and best practice to share, which is a digital innovation. But before I start, I would like to ask you all a question. Since we are here in Egypt, do you know how many smallholder farmers exist in Egypt? Estimate. $1 million, $2 million. So, we have more than 5 million smallholder farmers in Egypt, which is the size of New Zealand. So it's like a country inside a country. Smallholder farmers in Egypt, I will give a very brief about the nature of the smallholder farmers. They represent 80% of the total cultivated areas here in Egypt. And they are scattered, which makes it very difficult to reach. So imagine that this is the large base of the farmers we have in Egypt, and reaching them is not an easy task. So in BASF, we are very committed when it comes to sustainability. So we have very clear pledges, ranges from smart farming, smart stewardship, digital innovations. And today I'm giving one of the examples of the digital innovations that we have created 2 years ago. We have launched 2 years ago in Egypt specifically. And now this innovation has been transferred to different countries all over Africa, from Morocco and Algeria. By next year it will be launched. So I know that in this picture we have mobile agriculture clinics. This is another project that we have to reach out to these smallholder farmers. So education to support and educate the smallholder farmers is key. So this is what we do. We go around the scattered areas in mobile vehicles, and we have our agronomists and doctors to meet face to face with the farmers. The idea is to give them the best solutions to their pests and to their infected crops. So it is the best solution, I believe, because face-to-face interaction is best with the smallholders. But yet, when I mention 5 million smallholder farmers, you need to be smart. You need to check how can we reach out to the most the large number of farmers. So we started the pilot on tomato crop. And why tomato crop? Because tomato crop is a strategic crop in Egypt, and most of smallholders, they cultivate tomatoes. So we decided to have this innovation and to reach millions. Of course, the tomato farmers are not 5 million. So I'm just giving the whole number of the smallholder farmers. So this innovation is an early disease warning system on fungicide disease. So next slide, please. Okay, so this system we have built from scratch and designed a digital system that has three main pillars. The first pillar is the weather data, which I believe the most essential data that we should have and include in our system. The second is the beacon data, which is the on-ground observations, the disease onset on ground. The third one is the BSF expert data, and we call it the historical disease data, which is also very important component to have in the system, because we build the system on these three components. And at the end, the result we have is disease risks that ranges from very low to very high disease risk. I don't want to get into too much details, but it works on three main diseases for the people who knows. It's early blight, late blight, and powdery mildew. And how do we communicate this system to the farmers? It is through communication channels. So we have three main communication channels. We have WhatsApp. WhatsApp is not for the smallholders, it's for the retailers. And in this system, we have also included the retailers because they are the main influencers on farmers. So they should as well be well trained and well educated to divert the farmers correctly. And the other tool is IVR, interactive voice messages. And yes, we use it because we have some farmers that are illiterate. So it's the best way to have a voice call, and you just listen to what you should do. The third one is a normal SMS, which I believe most of the population are having. I won't say smartphones, but at least a normal phone so they can receive messages. And we have two complementary applications because, of course, to what we need to do is to register the farmers on the system. So definitely we won't do it manually. So we need an application. So we have a registration app where you can register the farmers, or the farmer register themselves, and or retailers register the farmers. We collect very precise data from the geolocations, correct geolocations, the phone number, the crop details, the variety of the tomato, as well the size of the farm. So can we have the next slide, please? Okay. So this is a live screenshot from the digital system itself. So you can spot the blue spots are the farmers' locations and the farmers' data. The purple ones are the retailer data. And you can see easily the weather data points we have. So it's very accurate when it comes to weather data and locations. So can we have the last slide, please? So this outcome, I believe, is achievement, because we had more than 7,000 farmers, smallholder farmers registered, and 1,700 retailers. And 7,000 smallholder farmers represent 23% from the total tomato farmers, which I believe is definitely a big number. And we have launched this 2 years ago, just after the the pandemic, and it served us very well because during the pandemic we were not allowed to go face to face and meet with the farmers. So having a digital solution like this, reaching out to a lot of farmers, was the best solution that we could have provided to the farmers. Next year we are considering expanding to different crops. This was the pilot phase, and it was very successful. So I'm sharing as a best practice, and I hope to see it on all crops. It takes a lot of time to calibrate the system, I have to admit, but it's worth it. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for all of your presentations, and thank you for such an illustrative example and sharing those statistics. And it's just so inspiring to see the opportunities in agriculture and especially in innovation. And so, you know, we are, as many of the speakers reflected on, so excited to see agriculture as a thematic day here at COP. I was sharing at an earlier event today that it's because of farmers around the world and their production that fed all of you before you came here today. And it enables all of the sectors to exist and operate because you don't have to worry as much. And so it is an opportunity, but as you've heard in some of the presentations, it's a challenge. You know, farmers are facing increasing challenges every day, many of which are a result of climate. And so we need more innovation and more solutions. So we'd love to hear from the audience. We'd love to hear your thoughts, your questions, reflecting on the presentations you heard today. And so if you have a question to ask of the panelists, you can just raise your hand and we'll bring the mic. Yes, I think. Thank you, Lori.
Good afternoon. It's afternoon now.
Yes.
Hi, everybody. My name is Aaliyah General. I'm from the National Trust of the Cayman Islands. And my focus for the COP this year, other than just kind of exposing or understanding how COP works as a whole, because it's my first, and bringing the youth perspective to COP, I wanted to be able to get information on how I can increase food resilience in my home country. We in the Caribbean, we used to be known for our agricultural sector and the way that it supported our people and the way that it put us on the map. And now, because of industrialization and globalization, that isn't as much the case for a lot of the more developed countries. But I think I'd like us to get back to that, because there's a lot of money that is spent on importing and exporting goods that doesn't go back into our economy. So I guess my question for the panelists would be, how would I, as a member of the youth, get my government to listen and understand to these ideas that I have about reinstating the importance of the agricultural industry and giving the Caribbean people and the Caymanian people, who are farmers, a lot of them, the opportunity to capitalize on that.
Thank you. Thank you for coming to COP and experiencing it. That's so exciting.
Thank you. Yeah, of course.
Of our panelists, so anyone want to address?
I'm happy to start, but you know, feel free. First of all, you've got a few things working for you. Lack of feedback always helps. The first thing is that you're here. Right? So this is your first COP. Welcome. This may not be your last COP, I hope. And you have a stage here, right? By asking questions, by engaging in this dialogue, by showing up other places and talking to a number of folks who can help to elevate that. I think the second is a bit more grassroots, which starts at home, which is often, and we see it in the United States especially, right, that as countries become more urban, more industrialized, the connectivity with farming tends to fall to the wayside. Why? You know, in a country like the United States, farmers are only 2 or 3% of the population, feeding the entire country and then some, right? So find your coalition, find your voices to build up with you, because I'm sure they are there. And the fact that you are of your generation means that you've got the energy, the voice, and the wherewithal to be heard. But start this week. Start here. Find others. We'll go with you. and build on that.
Yeah. I can't agree more, but I would add that adaptation. So I agree that lack of feedback is key as well. So maybe you have like farmer associations or organizations that can have like from, I don't know how it is segregated in your country, but in each segment or each continent has a farmer organization that can have together, like they talk together and they can definitely get to know what is how to adapt to your country's climate, your country's soil, to your country's different components in agriculture. So and I believe in COP you have the best chance to get more, because all the organizations, all the international associations are here, and I believe everyone is here to support.
So just to build on that, and then I'll hand it to you. You're at the right pavilion. So ask the folks who are here about what those groups are, because I'm pretty sure some of them presented earlier today. This is a home base to help get some of those answers. And then to the point about climate adaptation, you have a pitch to offer too, which is that these agricultural solutions can help to provide support to an island or a set of islands that is already experiencing the effects of climate change. And you can be a part of helping farming and agriculture and production can be a part of offering some of that ground resilience and health of your land.
Nothing to add. And let's talk offline after the panel. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your question. I think you need to find like-minded people, organizations, but I think you found a family as well here. So let's talk afterwards.
Thanks so much. And you know, I know they gave you a lot of advice. My advice is for everyone in this audience to approach her afterwards and give her your business card. She's giving you an opportunity here to engage on a public-private partnership. And she's part of the movement to bring agriculture back to life, back and bring those new innovations. So I challenge you all to leave. She should leave here with her pockets full of your business cards. That's the opportunity. Next question from the audience.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My name is Brian Sievers. I'm a farmer from Iowa. I'm here with a group from an organization called Solutions from the Land. So I think, first of all, with regard to your question, we might have an opportunity. We'll catch up with you later. But that's really what we're involved with is a way to reach farmers and talk about sustainable solutions in their farming operations. How can we implement climate smart farming practices? Do so in maybe a more circular fashion. But I have a question, I guess, for the three of you. You are all obviously heavily involved in sustainability. And by the way, I do use products from all three of your companies on our farming operation. And we are very focused on sustainability in our farming operation. But what are you doing to reach out to your customers to make sure you're hearing from them as to what your companies can do more to advance sustainable practices? I think that that's a very important role as sustainability officers or chief officers for sustainability, is to make sure you're hearing from a cross-section of your clients or your customers on how they can spread the message that you're spreading as well.
Okay, thank you, Brian, for your question. Okay, I will give a very detailed answer. So reaching out to farmers, I believe one of the digital solutions we have is the early disease warning system for smallholders. We have social media as well. So we have the Facebook page, we have YouTube channel. And at the end of all these pages, the farmers can reach out to us directly by direct messages. We have our hotline number. So whenever they have any question, they can reach out directly again to our team. We have a technical team as well dedicated on ground. So we have a very smart business model. I'm talking now in about Egypt, but maybe on the other two responses were general. So Facebook, YouTube, everyone is using now the social media, which I believe is a very strong platform for reaching out to farmers. But for every country has its own business models. So for example, in Egypt, we have a route to market, which is very smart. So we have a lot of manpower, let's say it this way, on ground. So we have technical support on ground. We have our mobile agriculture clinics that is roaming all around the area. We attend the agriculture exhibitions. So whenever any farmer organization or farmers directly can come to our booth and we definitely support any question from them. We even can schedule visits to the farms. So whenever there is a problem at the farmer, he can reach out directly and he can send even pictures if he has a problem with a crop or in his farm. So, and then we schedule a visit to the farm directly. So I believe it's not a big issue because we are there. And this is part of our sustainability to if we don't reach out to farmers, so what are we doing? So this is the main idea about this. Thank you.
Hi, thank you for your question. And I've visited Iowa very recently, and I have a lot of I run in Germany with many of my Iowa shirts as well, so spreading the love in Europe. Thank you for your question. I think what we've done and always open to get criticism, but what we are making sure as we launch and as we scale our carbon farming platforms, our sustainability platforms, is having farmers council, counseling us and advising us every step of the way. We have done, and then in the US, we went through a long process having that exchange with farmers. We changed our foreground, our carbon platform approach in terms of, for example, duration of contracts, in terms of how you evaluate practices and how we share data. So we are doing that in a very, with our commercial organization, but as well with our sustainability staff, as closer as possible, not only to identify pain points, and as well, farmers are our customers. So if we're not able to give them tailored solutions and walk with them in this journey of sustainability, we're not gonna be successful, then I don't have a job, and then that's not good. So what we are making sure is having those farmers council, specifically on our commercial platform as well, what we are launching now end of the year in our sustainability strategy long-term. And then listening to and getting the feedback in every strategic pillar, and then on the specific projects that we put forward. So open to hear your feedback and anyone's feedback on how that goes. But that's fundamental for us to have any type of commercial offer and how we're planning to advance our sustainability strategy as well. So hope we can continue the dialogue. And thank you again. Thank you for staying and hearing from us as well.
Maybe a couple of additional examples. So I'll call them three different things: input for inputs, reflections from reps, and champions for climate positive farming. So input for inputs means that across our R&D development and innovation, we start with input from farmers, right? So we have a bottoms up and a top down approach to our innovation, but it starts with understanding, taking that feedback from across the countries where we are helping farmers to grow, understanding those needs, those challenges, working backwards from there. Reflections from reps is every day we've got representative sales reps on the ground walking alongside farmers, and those reflections come back. And we hear from those reps what's working, what's not working, what are the farmers telling us? And then that gets shared and escalated too. But farmers need a platform to share their challenges more broadly. And so we've also created the Climate Positive Leaders Program, which intends to, around the world, champion the voice of farmers so that they can amplify the journey that they have been on, as well as the challenges and the barriers that they are experiencing, and open that dialogue and that opportunity for solutions to be brought forward from any number of corners.
Thanks so much. And those are such detailed examples. I can't help myself but just say they must be working if you're using all of their products on your farm already. So with that, I think we have time for one more question, please.
I'll be quick. Thank you very much for your work and outstanding presentations. I've recently come from New Zealand, where I've been working in climate policy. And in New Zealand, the GMOs are restricted, not allowed to be used. And there's and particularly amongst farmers in developing worlds, there's growing sentiment that perhaps innovation isn't the way. Perhaps we need to use less pesticides is always a good thing. Less inputs is always better. Whereas I think everyone in this room probably agrees it's more of a sort of issue by issue circumstances. So I guess my question is, what can farm organizations, farmers, anyone in the industry do to restore public trust in the innovations being developed by your companies and used by farmers? And what can farmers do more to restore that social license to operate and to show that innovations are going to be used sustainably, and what can we do to stop them not being used sustainably and not shy away from the problems, I guess.
Thank you for your question. And that's the big question. And that's, I think, the challenge that we are all trying to do. I think, first of all, it is yesterday we were here at this house. This is a great house to have that conversation. And I see Manuel here. I think we were here at ICA, and actually our company, I showed a slide where you could see the evolution of sustainable intensification and how we are optimizing, land use, land management with technology. And I'm preaching to the core here. We all know that, but this is a strong message that we need to continue to share, and we need to continue to share with policymakers, and then farmers like you and all of you that are here listening to us today. I think is inviting those policymakers and those consumers groups and organizations to see that from themselves in the fields. There's nothing better than going to the field and learning in the field and seeing that to convince those groups. And I think we need to take, here is the international influential community that comes to those COPs. I think we need to target it in a good way, but we need to target those influencers and those opinion leaders and take them to the farm and show them how the technology has been improving not livelihoods, yields, but as well sustainable outcomes from farmers, and how we want to do the big leap now and now measure those outcomes and then get revenues, additional revenues, and from those outcomes. So I know it's hard, and I've been in 20 years in food and ag, and I know it's frustrating at times, particularly for farmers, but I think we cannot give up. But I think the really showcasing and then opening your farm to those key opinion leaders, I think is critical, and not giving up of having that advocacy and engaging with governments. I know it takes time from your farm and that costs, but it's so fundamental that we do that and we continue to do that with strong case studies. And then just showing the benefits of technology. Now we are talking about gene editing, and then There's so much regulatory pressure in a few specific regions of the world, and then that backlash is in other places. So how we can talk more about the benefits and make sure that us as a network do that the best of our ability. So I didn't give you a detailed answer. We're all frustrated, but count on us. And I really think on the power of demonstrating and having the organizations that maybe don't understand much, but are in the food and ag space, have those leaders visit and see and hear from the farmers themselves.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. You know, I would never dare to tell a farmer what to do. I don't think that's my place. But feedback that we get from farmers, and that, you know, was riding in a combine during harvest in Iowa, actually, come to think of it, just a month or two ago. And what they say is it's helpful to be able to share what works and what doesn't work. And there's both sides of that, right? Technology is not a catch-all. There are so many other variables that affect success of any particular acre that you are farming, and it helps to share the whole picture. That's what we hear. Beyond that, you know, one picture, and I don't come from ag, right? I didn't grow up in it. I live in New York City. I'm surrounded in an urban area by people who don't understand. And one of the examples that I find helpful to share when I'm walking around with my Corteva shirts and my crop top shirts that have, you know, corn, soy, and wheat on them is to have the conversation about what we experienced this year. We had a record hot day just this week in New York City, November, and it was 80 degrees Fahrenheit outside, which is, you know, in the upper 20s, maybe lower 30s in Celsius. Insane. And then saying, we want to make sure that there's food security, climate resilience. And that's an area of common ground. I think we all usually agree on the outcome. It's the how that we get stuck on. And because it's a tangible thing to experience the rate of change of how unpredictable weather is, how a particularly hot or particularly cold day feels, and then start to talk about how long it takes to develop a seed variety and to develop the next way to protect it from a disease that may affect it. And if you want to look at existing technologies being on a 15 to 20 year development time horizon, and natural evolution of that seed taking even longer, and what technology, including a long history with GMOs, has allowed us to do for speed, for solutions, and protection of those seeds' potential over time, it really, I find it opens a door to the conversation. But again, I'm not going to tell you what to do, but those are just some ideas.
Okay. So I don't have much to add to what they just said, but I think there is no right and wrong here. So and no one can force anything. So I know it's some countries it's not legally approved, or for example in Egypt it's not. So that's why, but I would capitalize that best practices is or pilots, so you can show the results, concrete results, to convince. So this is the best you can actually do. Thank you.
Thank you so much. If you could join me in giving our panel a round of applause. And now over to Margaret.
Thank you again, everyone, for coming. This amazing panel of women and wonderful question. Thank you again for your question. We want to connect you with our ICA regional director in the Caribbean after this, because he's here. But we started the day hearing from Al Gore, sort of next door. And we're going to end the panel hearing from another wonderful leader in climate change and agriculture, Director General Manuel Otero of ICA. And he wants to give just a few closing remarks.
Thank you, Margaret. What a depression being compared with Al Gore. Wow, wow. What a pity. I wasn't able to be in two different meetings at the same time. So I missed the opportunity. In any event, let me emphasize that ICA, as a regional cooperation organization that look at the rest of the world, strongly believes in strategic alliances with public sector, with private ones, with NGO, because this issue is so complex that we have to act together in a very collaborative way. This home represents this joint efforts. It is a critical time. We need farmers at the forefront of all negotiations. We strongly believe also in science and innovation, and we are defenders of agriculture as part of the solution and not of the problem. I admire this panel with only women. We think ICA point of view is that the only way to transform agriculture is women participation and young people. So thank you once again. ICA is an open door institution, please count on us. Thank you. Thank you.